Thank you. All right, small crowd here, but people at the back, 20 or 30 rows of people back, but hi there for anyone watching this online. So I'm Martin Duguyams from Moodle, and we're just going to talk a bit about the Moodle project, how it works, and might be interesting. Please ask questions anytime. So Moodle originally was Martin's object-oriented dynamic learning environment because I started this project. And at the time when it was called that, I was the only user and the only developer, and it was just me. And like many projects, there's a guy sitting on a computer or a woman sitting on a computer just... as soon as other people started to join, I thought that's not a good name, so I changed it to Modular Object-Oriented Dynamic Learning Environment, which explains somewhat what it is, but we'll get into a little bit more about that. Let's just talk about some history. I grew up here, in the middle of Australia. That is the size of my classroom at the time, so I was doing my school on shortwave radio. See a little box with a handset, over, all of that. These dots are where my other students were in my classroom, and that's the size of Spain. Pretty big classroom. So that's like me on my radio. And I got very used to learning over technology. This was back in the 70s, because I'm that old. So there was no internet obviously then. Now, there are still kids who live out here in the desert, and now they use the internet, they have satellite connections, and they use Moodle. So I had a background in both computer science and education. I skip a lot of history, but Moodle is the result of computer science, which is essential in any open source project, but you need to also usually have some other discipline. Whatever the software is about, you need to have the skills in that thing. And I realized when I was working at a university that I needed more skills in the communication, in the education space. So I did a master's in this and a PhD in this, and I was working. Now Moodle, just conceptually, is a core learning platform. It's a piece of software that's written in PHP, which was chosen. I chose at the time, it was my third prototype. I chose PHP because it runs on the greatest number of places. All web hosts, even back then, 15 years ago, or more, could run PHP. And all the other nicer, more exotic technologies could not. The core platform has a lot of plugins, and the plugins connect to other systems. You have integrations with other things. And what the platform does is it brings everything together. You arrange them, the different activities, the plugins, the different integrations, you arrange them into courses. So conceptually, you have a course which is, here's something to look at, here's something to do, is an interaction with another system, and you build a sequence of activities, and that's what a course is, an online course. And then you access that through desktops, through mobile phones, tablets, through VR coming up, and the augmented reality, virtual reality space is very interesting. It's going to be, you know, in some years you can see that those screens on our phones are going to be glasses. It doesn't really matter that it's PHP because there's different ways to interact with it in this space. And voice. Voice interfaces are becoming more and more popular, and so we're also thinking about those. We don't need to redevelop the basic structure, because even in 100 years, if you're going to have a course, it will be a sequence of activities. Read this, do this, whatever. Maybe it's a VR activity instead of a writing activity, but it's an activity. So Moodle can look like this. This is a very boring one. It can look like this. This is another page in Moodle. But it can also look like that. It can look like this. And what people usually do is they take Moodle as an open source package off the shelf, they turn a lot of things on and off, they customize the look of it, and what I sometimes call Moodle, Moodle's not a learning management system itself. It is a learning management system maker, an LMS maker, because it's a generic tool for creating the learning management system that you need. Lastly, I just want to talk about something that often gets missed when you talk about software projects, which is why. Yes, it's fun to make things, but why? This is why we exist. We are here, the Moodle Project is here to empower educators to improve our world. I think I might have a t-shirt. So the mission needs to fit on a t-shirt, in my opinion. What we're trying to do, we are not trying to teach anybody, we are trying to help educators do their job. So I cannot possibly, with my cultural background, tell someone in Kurdistan how to teach. It's not right. People in Kurdistan should be teaching the way they want to, the subjects they want to, and how they want to. Any other viewpoint is very cultural imperialism. Likewise, we're not trying to automate education. We are not saying, hey, humans learn from machines, right? We're not building AI tutors. And I don't think that's the future, if you really think about it, that you really want. We don't want everyone learning from machines. So this is very essential. We are trying to make the best platform to do this. And we are very strongly connected with this. These are the 17 UN sustainable goals. So the UN has spent a lot of time coming up with 17 reasons, 17 things that we need to be working on, the whole planet, to actually make the world sustainable. Not even a great place to live, just sustainable, because there's so many problems going on with all of the things this is referring to. I'm not going to go into them in detail. Number four is about quality education. And we are directly connected with that because we believe that by quality education, you can empower students to have a wider perspective on the world and its problems and solve those problems. The generations that come are going to have to solve all of these things. We can improve that through quality education. This kind of backing to the reason why we work on a project helps organize an open source project. People will come to the project for a reason. People are working with us for a reason. Our company, in the middle of it, it's one of the main things we want people to understand when they join us is that they're doing this. The purpose comes first. Lastly, I want to talk about values. Something else that you don't hear much about with software, especially if you're associated with Silicon Valley, which is important. Building software, you have to have certain values. And free software people understand this, I know. Here, in our project, education is the biggest value. Education, this is an education situation. Every conversation is education. Every team working together on a piece of software is educating themselves about what that software is and how it should work. And of course, the whole mission is about education. Openness, we try to keep everything open. We try to be open about everything as much as possible. We haven't got to the point of publishing all our salaries yet, but we might get there. This is the kind of openness is how the world is going to be fixed. Respect, even for competitors, we don't go around trash talking other software projects. If those other software projects are achieving the same goals as us, then this is a great thing. The only way to beat things you think are wrong are by doing better. Integrity, so we try and have integrity in our personal lives and in our professional lives, and just everything should be open, right? This is connected with openness. And lastly, innovation. Open stuff naturally breeds innovation. People innovate on top of open stuff. But we really try and encourage that even in the Moodle project, for people to be creative, to try new things, to experiment. So, going to cut to the chase, talk about where we are right now with our development, and I'm going to hand you over to Sarah, one of our lovely developers, and she'll explain the rest.
My English is not as good as sorry for this. Some numbers, because Martin has asked how was created the model, but now, for instance, there are more than 25 people with Middle HQ. There are people around the world. The main office is in Perth here, but there's a lot of people around the world, other things. And we are going to open here and an office in Barcelona. That's why it's also as big as the Perth one. And there are more than 90 partners, companies working. More numbers. There are more than 94,000 registered sites, so probably there are more than this because not all models are registered. There are a lot of models registered here in Spain. It's the second country. The first one is the United States, I think. The 230 countries which uses Moodle, so it's a lot of places where it is used, and some other numbers about the activities. Moodle is more than a project, more than a resource project, it's a community also, because there are a lot of users who can use it. People from universities, from schools, from companies, or even personal people for himself. So it's for everybody can use it. And there is not a lot of people involved in the project. People with the development and the support, people from HQ, as you can see before, we are 55 in the company, but it's a lot of people helping us. There are the partners. This is a lot of private support and a lot of millions of volunteers, not only developing, just also people helping us with the translations, with the forms, we will see which kind of support they give us, but it's a lot of people, more than 600 developers working and contributing to this project, so it's so nice to have the chance to improve this kind of this project. Martin has shown before a little bit how Moodle is organized. We have a basic framework with some IPs and some libraries. We also have some core components which can be disabled, some of them, but can be disinstalled. And we also have some plugins. Some of them are included in the core version, some activities, the main ones, the ones that the people ask. They are most useful, but there are also more plugins that which are not included in the core version. It's so easy to install, remove, develop. So it's quite easy. So let's see different ways of contributing to Moodle. For instance, if you are a developer, you can create your own plugin that you can upload to the plugins database. There are different kinds of plugins. You can create your own activity, your theme, you can create some tool, some authentication method, so it's different. It's more than 50 things, it's a lot of kinds of plugins. You can also contribute in the tracker. You can report some, if you find a bug while you are working in Moodle, you can report a bug, or you can help us fixing it, providing the patch for fixing. You can add comments to the tracker is open, everybody can register, and it's so easy to contribute. You can also give new ideas, things that you missed in the current version, or things that you think that it would be nice to improve. It's so easy to create these issues in the tracker and to make them move. You will see later how it works. You can also contribute to the Moodle Docs, writing documentation. There is a lot of documentation in Moodle. weird. Almost everything is documented, so you can find documentation about how it works and also about development, which apps are we using, which how is organizing internally the plugins. Everything is in these repeats. You can also contribute giving support. There are different forums in different languages. There is also one in Spanish and also another in Catalan. And everybody can register and everybody can help other people and or ask for help if needed. And this is working because of the community also. So it's so nice to see or to follow or to help or to get help from this kind of spaces. And you can help also to the translation. It's so important to you like to find your these applications in your languages, and it's so nice to find it in these languages and even to contribute. It's so easy. There's a super easy interface, and you can translate. Everybody knows the languages. You can translate it to more than 150 languages, so it's easy. Right? And last way, contributing is from, there are different ways of contribute. There are the partners which are paying part of the money to Moodle. There is also Moodle Cloud, which are, you can take a Moodle Cloud site or with a basic installation, and if you want to use more users, you can pay a little bit and to have more users. There is also the Moodle Users Association, where you can pay every year, and if you pay, you can vote the issues that are going to get done. You can also vote if you are not the Moodle Users Association, but you have more importance if you are here. Every year, some of the features in the last versions has been because of the Moodle Users Association, so it's a very good idea, and it's working so well because it's are the users who decide how to invest this money. And also, this is the branded mobile apps, which the mobile team is here in Barcelona, and it's there is people who want, or companies, universities, they want to get a mobile app customized with the colors, the logo, they can't pay to get this branded app. And how works the development process? We have two kind of releases. There are the major releases, every 6 months, so twice per year. And every 2 months we make a minor release, or two bigger ones and a little bit more, six short. When we release a version, this version is supported during 1 year, one full year, supported with bugs and security. And after this, it's only 6 months more for security. We have also a LTS version, which now it's the 3.1 version, and it has the same for the full support, so 12 months, and it has 18 months for the security.
Yeah, so that means you have like 5 or 6 versions supported at the same time?
Yeah. Now, this is now. Now, this is here, but we are working in 3.5 now because it will be released on May. But we are working now in 3.1 and 3.2 only for security issues. 3.3 and 3.4, it's all fully supported, so yeah, we are working on all these versions. It's hard because you have to make backports every time you solve an issue, but not everybody can update their model every year, so yeah, that's why we some years ago was decided to have the LTS version also. So. And how works the development calendar for each version? For instance, the 3.5 version, which is the one we are working now. We start planning now practicing after release the previous version, the 3.4, it was in November. From then we plan the what we are going to do, and we are now working on this. Ander helps us a lot. He's our manager, and we decide which are the main features we want will be included in the 3.5 version. And from this we are working. A new version will be released in 2 weeks. It will be a minimal version. And after this, this August, we have 18 months before the release, the date, the final date. We have all the new features in a prototype space because we want the community help us test, they give their opinion. So it's quite important. After this, we make the code freeze, 21 weeks, in the 21 week. After this, we start a QA test. We have a bit of, I don't remember the exact number, but it's a lot of QA. This is also can be done for us, but also for the community. It's another of the contributions of the community because they are on the tracker and everybody can take these issues and it's only to stay the is the instructions. That's all. And before the release, it's also we prepared the documentation with the new features because the users have find the documentation when they release the version. So that's more or less the calendar is to follow. And which tools we use for the develop from the development point because there are a lot of. From the development tool, point of view, we work a lot with the tracker. The tracker is for us the place where all the issues, even the new features are in the tracker. Everything is in the tracker. Bugs, new features, improvements, created by the community and also created by us. We also have a development forum, so any person can ask there. I want to create this plugin. What I have to do or things. I have this problem. They can ask this forum. We have an open developer chat on Telegram, so everybody interested in. It's also another way to get answer to some quick questions. The code is of course published in Git and GitHub, and we have some continuous integration systems. To make sure that the report, everything is working all right. This is the cycle of the while an issue is open until it's closed. You see, anybody can open an issue. It's open in the tracker. You can register, it's for free, it's so easy. There are different kinds of issues, bugs, improvement, or new features. And you can vote, the things that you have before to create an issue, you can look for the issue, and if it's created, you only have to vote and say, yes, I'm super happy, I like this feature. When an issue is created, there are different teams which are in charge of the components, they decide it's a good issue and it will be done or not because perhaps it's a duplicate or it's not an issue because it's a bug, it's a, something that we can't reproduce. So if it's not an issue because it's something we can't reproduce, it's closed and that's all. And if it's triage, if it's an issue, we start development. Development can be done by people from HQ, but also by any developers. So you can say, hey, I want to work on this issue. Just write a comment and give us the patch with the GitHub branches and data. So it's some testing instructions to explain how to check that it's fixed with your batch, and that's all. So it's so easy. After creating a batch when an issue is solved, there is a peer review. Peer review can be also done by anyone, not only for people with from HQ. So if you write it, it's a very good way to learn about Moodle, because you don't have to create things, you have to review things that have been done, so it's an interesting way. There is a checklist in the documentation. They tell you that it's everything is documented, so and with the main points to review, so it's so quite easy. And when the peer review say that it's okay, this issue will be going to integration review. Integration review, it's only done on Monday and Thursdays. Every week, there is a special team dedicated for review in which issues are in this state, integration review, and they only do this Monday and Thursday. After this, the issues that are okay and pass the integration review, go to testing, which is always on Wednesday. And after this, Thursday or Friday, they are closed if the tests are okay. If not, if not okay, they come back to the development state. The integration review is done on for a specific team inside this queue. There's a special repository for them. There are different principles for which are so strict. They try to make consistent the system. It's a good way to make sure that the code is always good and everything is written on the same way. After all this, there's the testing. Testing is so easy, but it's not done only in this stage. It's also done in the during the development and even during the peer review, the integration review. So it's one more time for doing this in integration environment. And if everything is okay, this issue will be closed. So it's easy. It's quite long. It seems quite long, but it's once you learn, it's easy and it's a good way because you can help in different points. You can create an issue, you can develop you can create a patch, you can peer review, you can help with the testing, so it's other things that you can do. And just to know how we work, I'm working in the open source team, which is Sander is the manager. I'm working in this part, in the core components team. We have different components, as you see before, there are a lot of plugins included in the core, and what we have done some months ago is to create teams of two persons, and each team, mini team, is in charge of some components. So we are in charge of the component leaders of some of the components. Apart from the components, it is the mobile team, which is all the mobile teams here in Barcelona located. There's also the integration team, the one that I explained you before, the integration team does the integration review. And also a UX team for helping us to improve the usability, because it's one of the things that everybody is always complaining about. And apart from the open source team, there are a lot of other projects like the product, the education, human resources, communication, so a lot of people, 55 people are involved in this project. And Martin?
Sarah, I feel like we've got too much to talk about. We are at a very interesting point in this project. As I said, 15, 16 years of development. We've never been in debt. The whole thing has been bootstrapped like a very small cafe on the corner. So from the beginning, we've just grown like that. terms of the size of the revenue each year, the number of developers we have, it's been very smooth. However, open projects like ours are up against the Silicon Valley capitalist companies, the large enterprises that are trying to buy data and sell data and so on. And they have a lot more money going on. It was time for us to take it up more exponentially. So for the last couple of years, I was looking around for investors, someone who would invest in our project. And as soon as they started to talk about exits or return on investment, I said, I don't want to talk to you anymore. That's pretty hard to find investors like that. But we found one. I must have talked to about 50 different people, and we did find one. And it's a family, a European family, who are very wealthy. They really believe in the project, they believe in us, they believe in the culture we're building, and they also they have a lot of other involvements. But the one you may have heard of is something called Decathlon, giant sports store. So this company is 90,000 people, but they run it like a family business. There's four levels of management, and the culture in this organization is actually really interesting. And the more I talked to them, the more alignment there was we could see. And we really, so now we have a really good partner to help us with growth. This is not someone we're relying on for the project. They're helping us get to a new level. So we sat down and looked at what are we actually trying to do here, and we have eight big goals. Now I could talk further all day about the details of these, but we haven't got a lot of time. But I wanted to show you some of the thinking about what we're going to do with the project for the next 2 or 3 years. So we came up with eight big goals here. So the first one is to improve the quality of teaching practice. And I talked to them before, it's about quality. However, we've been talking about that for a long time, but we don't measure it. We don't go out and measure the quality of teaching. That's something we need to start doing. So we're working now on how we can find out if the things we're trying to do are actually effective. Are teachers actually empowered? Are they actually teaching better? Are students having better results? Is there more education going on, and so on? Secondly, we want to improve our reach worldwide. There's only so much you can do with internet social media marketing. A lot of it's about personal relationships. A lot of it's about forming relationships with other organizations, open organizations, non-profit, non-government and government organizations. We already have, for example, we have friends at the UN. The UN has 12 departments that use Moodle for various learning purposes. UNESCO use Moodle. Save the Children use Moodle. These are large organizations that we can work together with. And that's more of a... It's not software work, it's political work, it's business work, but it's with the right partners, everybody can win. We want to be a great place to work. The culture of how we work together, and Sarah's shown some of that, we have a lot of processes and things we've built. The culture of how we work together and how we talk together is something you can just let develop organically, and I think we have in the past. But now we're trying to be more organized about it, a bit more intentional about it. Everybody wants to live and work in a place where they feel comfortable, where they are able to grow, where they are able to have fun, but still have impact, and things like that. So we want to make a culture that enables that. So we have now new people at an organization that are not technical, they're not admin, they're focused on this, and we think that's going to be a good thing. We want to have really great connections with our community. Often in open software projects, and ours included in the past, we would say, hey, it's open source, just take it, go. You got a problem, fix it yourself. Send us a patch, right? It's
very easy to say that. It's not very nice to say that. And the users are who we're trying to help here, so we need to be working really close. And I think we've had a lot of things happening in past years to improve that. We have a lot of user conferences, for example. So we don't just have one a year. We have something like 20 or 30 conferences, and these range between 200 people and 600 people in countries all around the world. And at these conferences, we focus on letting users share experiences with each other, but also find to work with us so that we tell them what's new that we're doing, but we want to listen to them about what we should be doing, and it's a two-way street. But we have a lot of other online things that we do too, and there's something I want to show you shortly. It's a very, very new thing called MoodleNet. We want Moodle to always be feature competitive. I kind of never want people to pick Moodle just because it's open source or has good goals or any of our mission and vision. I would love it if people only picked Moodle because it was the best. I would love it if people picked Linux as their operating system because it was the best. The free software thing is good, but that should be extra. That should be like the absolute, you know, there's absolutely no doubt pick Oracle. But the features have got to be there. Because not everybody's interested in the philosophy, and people will very happily use Facebook because it works for them. And they don't care about privacy or data or advertisements or anything like that. So we have to be simply the best, feature competitive. All of our other products and services, we have to improve them. We have a lot of plans to improve, and this is a big bucket for a lot of things. This is very important. We have to be sustainable at a higher level. So I said before, we're hiring around 55 people. I want to be very soon at 100 people, and I want a whole business to be supporting 100 people, to be paid well, with good salaries, happy in their work, growing, continuing. And lastly, we have to improve how we sell. And the word sell is a really dirty word sometimes because it makes you think of people who are lying to you. But it's just, selling is marketing are about communicating what the value is. And we're traditionally bad at that because we're a lot of hackers, a lot of developers who think, well, it's self-evident. This is a good thing. You should all be able to see it's a good thing. But if people don't hear about it in this media-saturated world, then they're not going to know it's a good thing. So part of what we have to get better at in our project is making it clear. So we have five big things that we're working on, and these all work together. And this is the plan for the future. So we have Moodle as the learning management system, the main core product that gets developed, the thing that you can download. We have Moodle Cloud, which is the SaaS hosting platform, and we already have about 25,000 Moodle sites running on this cloud system. And there is a lot to do there to make it better and better all the time. But in this world, not many people are comfortable with downloading a piece of PHP software off a website, installing MySQL or Postgres, all of the dependencies and all that stuff on an actual piece of hardware and making that work and then maintaining it for years. Right? It's a different world now. It's a world of, oh, I heard about something, I want one of those, click, get it, now I've got it. That's where we are. We need these kind of services to exist, but it has to be as free as possible. And it has to be open in the sense that you can move your own Moodle site into the cloud, and if you want, you can move it out of the cloud. And you have that freedom, and you should know what's happening with the data all the time. Learn Moodle is a curriculum. We are educators. We need to teach people how to use software. So we're building a curriculum that's not just going through the features of this is this feature and this is this feature. That's documentation. This is an actual course that you take. It's broken into 23 modules. You can have certifications. It's delivered through our Moodle partners. So it's about a quality experience so that you come out with a certification. I am good at using this software. I'm a teacher who knows how to teach online. And most people who come from, even if they have a long teaching background, they will not be able to teach online without help. It's just not possible. They will do things the way they've always done, and that's not what you can, what you should do online. So it ends up that most courses are a bunch of PDFs or Word documents followed by a quiz. That's not a course, right? A course is a whole sequence of activities. It's an experience. The students are being brought through something exciting, and at the end, they really learn something. So that's about that. And our Moodle services is just about all the services. So through our partners, different products and branded Moodle mobile apps and all these sorts of things, we provide all the support people need to be able to be successful in using our software in their environment. And of course, that helps pay for all of the rest. And the last one is MoodleNet. The MoodleNet ties it all together and is probably the most exciting thing that I think we're working on right now. So we've undertaken to build a whole new social network just for educators. And we want it to be an icon sitting on your mobile devices right next to your LinkedIns, your Twitters, your Facebooks. It's just for educators. And we really want to design it well, learning from the mistakes of the past. When you look at social media now, the reason why you're seeing all these people walking down the street looking at their phones, you know, if they're looking at GPS, that's fair enough. But if they're scrolling, if you look at their screen and you see a whole lot of photos and text going by and they're doing that, well, that's because they're in the machine of these social media, which have been designed to capture your attention in 5-second chunks. They capture your attention and they sell your attention, basically your brain, to an advertiser. Because they're collecting information about you, selling that, but they're also getting advertiser information in front of you. And if you listen to the people who've designed the social media platforms, they're very openly explicit about this. This is what we are doing. There are people who have that job. How do we make it more addictive? You're designing for addiction. They're not worried about you as a person. They're not worried about you as a life. They're not worried about you in the world. They're worried about selling stuff. What we want to do is design this to be a support for the role of a teacher, so professional development. So it has to be something like a friend who's always there, who's always supporting you at the level you need all the time. If you don't want it, it's not there. And if you want it, it's there. We want it to be integrated with every Moodle site, so the many thousands, hundreds of thousands of Moodle sites out there connected, so that it's on the actual site where you're teaching, MoodleNet is hanging on the edge as your social network. But primarily, you're using it through the device in your hand or on your face. So the main purpose of it is to, as well as bringing people together, it's about creating and sharing content and services. So let me explain a little bit about it. So here are some of the components. It's got to have identity. You have to have an identity. You need an identity in the system. It's hard to, you can't get away from that. But when I talk about an identity here, I talk about an identity not like your Google account, but an identity like your email address. Your email address, and email in general, that's one of the best social media platforms ever, right? Email, we forget about email. Email's freaking awesome. Anybody here can build a server and make an email address, right? Maybe you have a few problems with spam systems, but you know, you can work all that out. And you can have your company, your school, yourself, you can make your own email server. And you can use that to communicate with basically every person on the planet who has internet. Isn't that amazing? And it's open. Nobody controls it. And it always works. And when it doesn't work, you get a bounce, and you know what happened. Like, it's a really cool social media network. We want to make identities in this system like that, somewhat centralized and standardized, but also distributed, so that people have control over their feeds. Now, when you have it, you need to have an identity because you need to have reputation. In the system, you need some form of reputation. I don't want to trust Microsoft to manage all their reputations. Microsoft own LinkedIn. Right? Everyone has LinkedIn accounts, whatever. It's the de facto system. In the education world, I don't think we need to be using LinkedIn. I think teachers and educators can have something built for them. We'll link to all the open projects of content. There are many, many OER, Open Education Resources projects, usually based on Creative Commons licensed materials. We want to work to bring them together so that for someone who's using Moodle, they have access to all of those in a nice, easy way without having to go to 500 different websites. We can do the integration once and bring it into one interface. For resources that don't exist yet, crowdfunding model. People should be paid for their work. This is critical. We should work to make models where people are paid for their work. Once they've made something from their work, it should be free. Because if it's digital. Because the cost of duplicating a digital piece of content is zero. It's just making more electrons. This is the whole fundamental thing behind open source, but it applies to all open content as well. So the way you should make content, I believe, is you have all the people who are interested in that content existing putting a little bit of money in together. So they get value from it. So, you know, say 100 teachers put $5 together to make something get created. So suddenly you have $500 or euros to pay somebody to do the work for two weekends and make the thing. And then, after that, it's free. It's Creative Commons. Now, you have messaging between people, you've got a news feed, but the news feed, I think, shouldn't be what is your filter bubble, what is your reality. I'm going to give you a news feed that's only what you want. It should be a news feed based on the kinds of experiences you want. We've got a lot of ideas, but I'll give you one example. Say you have these forum discussions going on, and somebody goes, I've had an insight, right? I've just thought of something a really cool idea, a really great idea. I think it will change how we teach physics, right? And a lot of other people go, yes, good idea, good insight, right? Now imagine if you could subscribe to insights, and you're getting physics insights and biology insights, and so you're just getting insights. So we can do filters based on different things than just the subject there. Filter on different kinds of information. So these are the kinds of things we want to experiment with in here. We just started building this, we've got a lot of conceptual work done. But the ultimate aim is it should be something you can trust, and really trust. It should be open, it should be safe, it should have privacy totally worked out, it should be ethical, it should be transparent. By transparent I mean there should be a page that says, MoodleNet runs on these servers. Here's who owns the servers. Here's who pays for the servers. This is the countries those servers are in. That kind of transparency, right? You should have a total understanding of how it works. And it should be very connected with itself and all the other systems around. So this is a very big, ambitious project. It's interesting when you talk to different people about it, they approach this elephant from different angles. You talk to a developer and they're going, what language should we build it in? And you know, you talk to a business person and they're going, okay, who's paying for this? And you know, you talk to an academic and they're like, you know, what's the philosophy behind it? But it's kind of, all these things have to come together. And I think our project is in the best place to see this idea and make it happen. So that's one of our big projects for the future. If you're interested in that particular project, moodle.com/moodlenet. Take you to a lot of blogs and information, and you may want to join in. I think
that's us. So thank you very much. Thanks for coming, and it's been a pleasure to talk to you about Moodle. Thanks. Anybody got any questions? Yeah.
So which license is it?
GPL.
Under? GPL.
GPL 3. We were on 2, and I switched it to 3 at some point, which was enough of a process, even though it's supposed to be easy.
So how does it, like, because GPL wasn't designed for websites.
Yeah.
So have you had any issue with that, or?
Yeah, there was some talk about using the Affero version, but I think the freedom under the GPL is enough freedom. We don't require anybody to give back changes or submit add-ons. So in that sense, on the website, it's kind of like the MIT license almost. It's very, very, people have a lot of freedom, which is good. But we do, I like the way the GPL enforces the freedom that you can't, you must give it to someone else under the GPL, which is the main thing. So it works good enough, and changing it, we had so many contributors, any changes at all to the license would be basically impossible. So, yeah. And we have a couple of other side projects, like our mobile app, which is very capable. We have a very good mobile app, and the team is here in Barcelona. They've been developing this for some years. And that app, which is on Apple devices, on Android devices, and Windows, is under the Apache license.
Can you improve the upgrade, the versions?
To improve?
For AC way for the user, for the final user.
Right, to make it like a WordPress upgrade,
yeah,
kind
so
of like a click.
Very easy to upgrade the version and not to have to.
Yeah, we've talked about it, obviously, many times. We've made some, that you can upgrade plugins this way. You can click and upgrade all the plugins. But an upgrade of the major version of Moodle is 10 orders of magnitude more complicated than WordPress, really. WordPress is actually a relatively very simple system compared to Moodle. Moodle has, I don't know, 250, 300 tables, something in it.
WordPress is only 6 or
7. Yeah, right. So it's a vastly more complicated system, and most of the users of Moodle are large institutions, and for them an upgrade, you wouldn't in the middle of the semester let it upgrade itself. You're going to affect thousands of students. So usually an upgrade is a big process of trial and testing and all that stuff. So it hasn't been so urgent to do that. If you do want a site that upgrades itself, you can go to Moodle Cloud and get a little site, and we upgrade that for you, so it's automatic.
Can you show what it looks like?
Yeah, sure. I knew someone would ask that. So, lots of places I could go. So we have some demos, a variety of demos on demo.moodle.net. And the thing about Moodle is it's like saying, can you demo WordPress or can you demo a lot of software? They're so customizable that they can look very, very different. But this site has the purpose of showing you some of the major features in a very kind of vanilla way. So it's not heavily customized. This is just showing the base product, if you like. So here's a bunch of courses. Let's go into that. So we have sort of menu which tucks away. We have the main screen, which is a whole list of activities going on.
And each of those activities are quite different. So this is a glossary. A glossary is like a whole lot of definitions. And when you can, this glossary, for example, can be created by the students. It can be an activity where you ask all the students to contribute to the glossary of definitions. And then all of these definitions become hyperlinks throughout the course. So if somebody later mentions one of them in a forum, it becomes a hyperlink back to this activity. There's a lot of sort of cross-linking between the activities going on. Or we can quickly look at a workshop. And it's difficult to see in this, but a workshop is a peer-graded assessment. So you may have a class of 1,000 students. No teacher wants to sit down and grade 1,000 assignments. So what you do is you get them to submit the assignments into the system. And Moodle takes care of giving... So let's say you want... So let's say three. Three people to grade your assignment, and in return, you have to grade three other students. So that way, even if that, if it scales to any number, right, you can have 10,000 students, and everyone has to do the same amount of work. So you take those three grades that you've got for a particular assignment, and you look at the grades of the people who gave you those grades. Right, so there's some mathematics going on in here. If a student got good grades for their assignment, you give them more weight on the grades they give to others. If a student themselves did very badly, then you don't give much weight to their grades of other people. So Moodle does all the mathematics, balances it out, and ends up with an average grade for each student. And surprise, surprise, this works really well. You actually get a result. Everybody is graded, and it works quite well. Now, there's a little bit of stuff in there to show students how to grade things and give them a rubric so that it's clearer how to do things. There's also, the teacher can get an overview of all of the things here. I'm not sure if I can show you that right now. It's not at the right state on this demo, but they can check, you know, if you want to go in and check any weirdness, you can. But it works surprisingly well. So that's just another activity in Moodle. There's these kind of activities, there's about 15 or so in core Moodle, all kinds of things. And then in our, if you look on moodle.org, and say you go to our plugins database, we have 1,451 plugins, 817 developers, 350,000 downloads in the last couple of months. So there's a huge community of people writing, say, activity plugins, but also all the other kinds of plugins. We have something like 25, 30 types of plugins where you can extend Moodle's functionality. For example, on the side of the screen here, we've got some blocks, and those are all plugins. If you log in as an admin account on the site, you'll see the administration menus. A lot of what needs to be done with learning in schools is it needs to be connected to other systems. We have thousands of integrations with everything. So it's very likely you'll have, I don't know, simplest case, maybe you've got an LDAP server running with all the accounts of everybody on. So Moodle will slave off that LDAP server, and that's how the accounts for the logins work, just for example. And so on. So, is that enough?
No, that's...
I mean, it's a million things, I could show so much, but... yeah.
This test for this test for Constantinople.
Ah, okay. Well, there's not much going on here. One can't see much.
But we have a problem.
Well, okay. You want me to debug this and then now? maybe now's not the time to go through this. Alright, so if you want a different...
You can't add another language or another tongue, Kurdish language.
So if you want a, if you want another language pack, you go to lang.moodle.org, and we've built a giant infrastructure here for translation. So the community have translated Moodle into... But on lang.moodle.org we have 110, 120 languages, translations that have been done, and each one has multiple people doing translations all the time. I think I sort of figured there are 131,000 streams or something. It's a pretty big project, lots of stuff going on. All right,
great. Thank you.
Thank you. Cheers.